So in the second video, we ended up by stating this wedge theorem, which restricts where in space our self-translating hypersurfaces can live. They cannot live in these vertical wedge-like regions, wedge-shaped regions. And so now what we're going to do is we're going to prove this. So just remind what the theorem says. If you have two vertical and non-parallel half spaces, in or n plus one, then a properly immersed translator cannot sit inside that region. So, and the way you prove it, so is as follows. Well, first I should say that I already explained how the proof goes in the case of minimal surfaces of Hoffman and Meeks, where they used these, I called them apple slices, which are these boundaries of a ball intersected with the wedge that you solve the plateau problem on and use that as a nonlinear barrier. But in fact, we're going to go actually a bit back in time for an argument, because Omori already had shown by this Omori argument, also known as the Omori-Yau principle, that you cannot have minimal surfaces sitting inside a cone. So that's of course a special case, right? Because cones sit inside wedges. And of course, cone here again is one that has a non-trivial angle, right? Okay. So, and then also there's the argument of Borbély, where Borbély did these minimal two surfaces in wedges. But in fact, you can see actually the Borbély's argument then in that case, well, there's a different argument, but the result already follows from the half-space theorem, right? Because if you want to show that you cannot sit, if you're a minimal surface and you want to show you cannot sit in a wedge, at least in the proper case here, then you also cannot sit in a half-space. What I'm trying to say is, if you sit in a wedge, then you sit in a half-space, and then you know, you cannot sit there by the half space there. Okay, yes. But let's get to then to the proof of this in the translator case. So what we'll use is this Moriau maximum principle, which is quite a general thing. If you think about it for hypersurfaces, then it works for proper hypersurfaces as long as you have bounded mean curvature of the hypersurface. And what it says is that if we look at properly immersed translators, so we have the translator case here by Singh, and then you can allow a boundary even, but you want the following properties. It has to be a continuous function, which is so property two down here says it's smooth enough where we need it. Okay, so at the places where the maximum can happen. And so then what we require is that it's a bounded function, and also the if we have boundary, then actually we don't want the supremum to be attained on the boundary. Okay, and then you have a similar conclusion as if you were on a compact manifold and use the maximum principle. And maybe I shouldn't say the word maximum principle, because it's more the definition of having a maximum on a compact manifold, but it's of course what we would usually use with the maximum principle for these, for example, for some elliptic PDEs. But anyway, what it says is that if you have such a function, then you have a sequence, which of course in the interesting case here will be something running off to infinity on the surface, on this non-compact surface. But then in any case, you get in the limit, you get the supremum value of your function f, the gradient in the limit tends to zero, and then you have a sign on the Laplacian, which is what you'd imagine, right? If you had some place here, well, it's what you would have if you had an interior point with the maximum right there. So it's the same sign on the Laplacian that you'd have at such an interior maximum point. But this really then guarantees that even on the non-compact situation, if you are a properly immersed translator, for example, Or as I said, more generally, if you have bounded mean curvature, then you have such a theorem. The reason we quote here Ching is just because now it's written out in a nice explicit way in his paper from 2015. So here comes then a sketch of the proof of this is a slightly weaker statement just because we assume no boundary here. So I remember to comment a bit on the compact boundary case. And so what we're up to show is that if you have vertical non-parallel half spaces, then you cannot have a properly immersed translator sitting inside this wedge shaped region. And yeah, and so I already commented on this that you have to do a little bit more to show the compact boundary case. And I already gave the counterexample in the last lecture for why it doesn't work for non-compact boundaries. The example we had there was a wedge and then half a Reeper cylinder. Okay. So then let's go to the proof. And so what we do is we take our wedge shaped region here. Okay. And then we assume that we have our properly immersed self-translator sitting somehow here. So this is then the E3 direction in this little picture. And actually pretty soon what I'll do is I'll go and switch the viewpoints to looking. Let's say we look from above. So you're looking down in the direction or the opposite direction of the translator. And then we have maybe some picture like this. Okay. And then now the setup is that you take, actually I should fill up the slide here so that the picture doesn't vanish, and maybe I can draw it down here. So I said, I'm looking down at the translator from above, maybe. Let me show it a bit more smoothly here. So let's see. So we had some translator sitting here, maybe with some topology out here. And then what you do is, there's only one parameter, and we're talking the test function here. So what you do is you say, I fix a radius R, and then I look at a circle here of radius R. So this also determines for you where this center of the circle is. And in fact, right, if you think about it, it's not actually a circle, right? It's really, because what I want to do is actually I take the distance cylinders, you could say, to one of these affine lines here. So, but actually, you don't have to worry too much about it. This picture shows pretty much what's going on. Because what you can see is actually, yeah, I should actually maybe have drawn a slightly different translator because my picture's a bit crammed. Because what you can do by picking the radius large enough is that you can assume that there is something sitting inside this interior chamber here, which is AR intersect sigma. So there is actually some translator sitting inside this interior part here. And so what you see is that, yeah, this region here, it may not be bounded, right? Generally will not be bound. We're looking down in the direction of the, well, opposite the direction of translation here. So it won't be bounded, but it'll have bounded projection in the translation direction there. And that's also why, yeah, this picture is pretty accurate even in n dimensions. And then yeah, we call that region A, this region inside here between the sphere we put in, which is really a cylinder, and it's a circle in this drawing. But and then the other region outside there we call BR. Okay, so simply two connected components of taking the wedge and removing this solid cylinder here. Okay. Okay. So let's see. So what we do, so already mentioned that this axis of the cylinder is actually an n minus one dimensional affine in our n plus one parallel to the direction of translation. Okay. And so now we can just take the distance function from LR and then modify this a bit. So this distance function is then bounded inside this interior chamber, like I call it, right? That's really because it has bounded projection in the direction of translation. It's unbounded in the wedge part outside of the cylinder and the interior chamber that we cut out. And then the function you define is as follows. For each point on the surface, if you're in the interior region, maybe you should have a drawing again here of how that looked. So the interior region is this part in here. This is the AR region. So there you'd be the distance function to the center of the of this cylinder, which is this in much more dimensional affine. And then you sort of taper it off to just have the value of R, which it does have on the boundary of the of this cylinder, right? And taper it off to have that value outside here. So maybe I can write like this, if is constant equal to R out here also. And then in here, yeah, if equals the actual distance to, which is the distance to LR. Okay, so this is the function that one uses for the Omori-Aoi maximum principle. So let's show that on the next slide. So we have first have to check that this function satisfies the properties needed for the Omori-Aoi maximum principle to work. So well, it's clearly continuous, right? It's also smooth away from these boundary bits that we have. It's also bounded, right? This is part of tapering it off, right? So it's just the distance to the n minus one affine inside the interior chamber, so it's bounded there, and then we let it taper off to be the value r outside. In fact, you can also see here that the supremum value is actually strictly larger than r. Right? If we go back here, you can see that, of course, because we have some parts of the surface which are outside here, then actually the supremum is larger than R, because R is what it has in the boundary here. And that'll be important in the argument. So I'd say that, yeah, let's say it this way, that also this also guarantees one thing, that the maximum is not assumed on the boundary, but we'll also have to use it later. So then we use the Omori-Aoi maximum principle. This means that we get a sequence, the Omori-Aoi sequence, which behaves here like interior maximum, but just on a limit of points, which may run off to infinity. And so we will have to use these properties of the Omori-Aoi sequence throughout the argument. And so we'll remind ourselves what they are when we need them. But remember, yeah, that it's like a maximum at an interior point. So and so to continue with the proof, then we'll need some of these basic hypersurface computations. So remember that the function that we're looking at, fr, is essentially, and at least in the region we'll be using it, it's the distance function to the affine. So remember that dr is, yeah, let me go down so I have the whole slide. So dr is really inside that region in ar. It's really the distance function to the affine n minus one dimensional, which is we called LR. This was the center of the solid cylinder. And then if you compute for such a distance function, then yeah, well, it actually has some quite simple eigenvalues. If you want to compute the Hessian and so on, and then if we do this computation with Hessian and trace it over the tangent space, then we can compute the surface Laplacian of F. And what we get is this term here, the first term that only involves the function itself. Now I've actually written this as dr here, because we'll just want to do it on our interior chamber, like I call it. And then we'll pick up here a surface expression here that can be rewritten to involve just the mean curvature vector and the gradient of the function itself, like this. Okay, but notice at this stage, this is still not using that the surface is any special surface such as the one we have here, which is the self-translating surface, right? So that's in the next equation that we plug in this expression for the mean curvature to see that, well, we just have this unit normal sitting here. Okay, and so this means that now we can actually go and use our Omori-Aoi property. Remember that this behaves like an interior maximum. We're taking the sup version, right? The sup of the function f is what we're looking at. So this one will be negative there. Okay. So our goal is to show positivity of this to get a contradiction. So yeah, written it on the slide also, right? That from the Moriao, from the maximum principle, we have this non-positivity of the limit of the Laplacian. And yeah, so what about this second term that we had on the previous slide? This, you can see, goes to the sup of F. And why is that? Well, part of being one of these Moriao sequences is that this gradient term tends to zero, right? So that's why you get a one here. And you're dividing by this distance. And that is then really the function F. So this is really the supremo value of F. Okay. And what about the gradient term here? I'll leave this to you to really think about why this works. It's nice to sort of draw a picture here and see that if you're looking at a place where you have a maximum of this distance away from the affine, so then actually your you can say that your gradient there will be turning in such a way that this goes to zero also. So that's maybe a little problem for you to think about. And what this means, if we plug it into the equation from the previous slide, is that this limit here of the Laplacian equals one over sup of the function. And if you remember, I pointed out, we should almost go back and show that I pointed out that that this one actually was bounded, right, from below. So this is bounded, or sorry, from above. So this is bounded. Let's maybe go back from below. And yeah. So it's really just because this is bounded here, right? So, okay. And so another way of explaining what we've done here is that to show that if the function that we're using, our test function here, is strictly submonic at infinity, and this is then what constricts really our Moriao, that it should be a limit of the Laplacian should be non-positive, but in fact, it's strictly positive by the computation. So that's where the contradiction comes from. And hence, you cannot have such a self-translating surface sitting inside a wedge-shaped region with non-zero angle here. Well, non-zero, non-pi angle, maybe we should say, because of this Moriao principle combined with this test function that takes the cylinder here with the affine going through here and taking the distance function to that, making sure that, of course, like we did, that the surface intersects the interior chamber that we call AR here. So this is, brief terms, the argument we did. And so before I actually go to the stuff about which examples exist, I have to remember to show how do we get the convex hull. I can probably just add it here to the slide. So how do you get the convex hull property from this? Well, maybe I can explain it first just for the mean curvature to zero case. This is the same argument that's done here. And so the following idea is what we use. We use that the convex hull of a surface. Okay. This can be written as the intersection of all of the half planes here. So actually, I would like to write it like this. So I do the intersection over H, and where what determines if H is in this collection of sets that you intersect? Well, H has to be a half space in Rn plus one. So I'm talking about n-dimensional surfaces inside Rn plus one still. And so it has to be a half space which contains the surface in question, like this. Okay. And so let's say that we have proven a wedge theorem. Well, then this large and complicated looking wedge of all these sets can be evaluated, right? Because if you had two of these half spaces which were not parallel, then you could apply the wedge theorem to say that, well, then can it can't be part of this collection of sets that you intersect. This means that you only have all of the parallel half spaces. So now we only have to think about what are the possible options you can have if you have an intersection of a collection of parallel half spaces? And it's not so hard to see that, let me just write it in this way. I already explained it before, that it's, that's why I put it in quotes, because it's a bit of a description of the possible sets that leaves a little work to do, right? Because it's slabs and degenerate cases, right? So just to avoid having to write the whole list. But the list again was that what's a degenerate case of a slab? Well, you could have just a flat plane, you could have a half space, you could have all of space, right? And including the slabs that don't degenerate. So those are the four cases in the situation without a boundary. Okay. And so so this was then explaining the argument just in the minimal surface case where there's not the extra complication of the vertical half spaces being the only ones we consider. So, but let's just talk briefly about that. Well, if you had this case and then we do all the verticals, then I just have to modify the same argument. I just put vertical half space there, right? And then the argument works just the same, because then we are ruling out the vertical ones that are not parallel. So vertical half spaces, and then you get the same argument. But now you see that since we have now, just these vertical ones, well, then you don't get the whole convex hull, right? So what you just have to convince yourself is that what I get is the projection in the translation direction of the convex hull that equals, so I might just write it up here. So those are all of the H, which are H vertical. Well, okay, now I wrote H a bit too many times here. So where H is a vertical half space, okay, such that H contains the translating surface sigma. Okay, so this is how the argument works. And now you see also, yeah, how is this projection coming into it? How does that play together with the vertical subspaces? Okay, or half spaces. So now let me look at this funny little list of examples, and including now a missing example, because it's not so hard to find examples of all of these types of convex hulls of projections in the translation direction of translating hypersurfaces in Rn plus one. So the first one, you could say, well, how do I get something which is has all of Rn? Well, there you can take, for example, the ball soliton. So you project this one, and then in one dimension lower here, there you will see that you have all of space, right? So check mark on this one. We have an example of that. Then what about the half space? Well, that one actually is an open question. This is the missing example. We don't have any examples of that. And so what about case three? We have, for example, a closed slab between two parallel half planes. How do we get that? Well, we can, for example, take a Reeper cylinder here, right? So if I take this one and project it, and I also take the convex hull of it, well, then I get a strip in R2 here, or more generally, you can make these slab examples, right? Okay, so we have an example of that also. And hyperplanes, well, the hyperplane itself is a translator, so that's where you get them from. And then there are these compact examples, or compact boundary examples. Let's not comment on them now. But yeah, this case two is actually missing, so we don't have examples of that. So this is an open problem. I can ask you here, does there exist a translator which has the property that the convex hull of the projection in the translation direction is exactly half space of Rn? So, you know, it has to be exactly, right? Because if not, these slabs and strips examples that are contained in half space could be examples, but we want it to be exactly a half space. That's the correct formulation of this open problem. And so it actually leads to another open problem, which we can call open problem two, because if you remember from the very first parts of these talks here, we had these examples of how to construct a translator by doing a product of minimal surface in one dimension lower with a flat line. Okay, so, and that would be an obvious way, right, to try to construct some of these half space filling, we could call them in the sense of the convex hull projected examples of translator. But it turns out this is also an open problem, even if there exists as a minimal submanifold that you could use for this product construction. Okay. I'll just recall to refer back to the first slide of the whole mini course, that in the case where the surface you're considering, in this case, it's a minimal surface we're talking about, which is two-dimensional, then the answer is negative, right? Simply by this Hoffman-Meeks half-space theorem. Okay. So, this proof, I didn't say this before, but I can say that now we also spend a lot of time talking about this type of proof, that they use catenoids as barriers to show this half-space theorem there, okay, to rule it out. And then, as I already mentioned, also in the first talk, if you have high dimensions, then you have these higher dimensional catenoids, and they're actually asymptotically planar, so they look something. In of course, I'm trying to do a sketch of something in higher dimensions now, but then they are asymptotically planar now. Okay, and this is an interesting property. It's ultimately, you can think of it as having to do with the Green's function of the Laplacian, right? Where you have the logarithm in two dimensions, and in high dimensions you have these power functions. So this is this x to the 2 minus n behavior, right? Versus log of x. That you have. Okay. And there you can see that, so it's easy enough to give these slab examples, for the minimal case, but whether or not you can fill out a whole half space is an open problem. We get to the promised part about ancient flows. So ancient solutions, I'll remind you, just means you have a mean curvature flow, which is defined all the way back from minus infinity, from negative time, and then possibly up to some finite time. It could be, well, it includes the case if you had it existing to plus infinity time. The important part is just to say that, well, it existed going all the way back to minus infinity time. Okay. I didn't really make a big deal out pointing out that these are, of course, the more general case of singularity models you get, because if you do your parabolic rescaling around singularity, right, then it could be hard to figure out what happens with the convergence properties and so on, like we discussed in the first lecture. But one thing's for sure, that is, if you rescale your time and you're maybe saying time zero is your singular time, well, then you'll be rescaling your time direction. So you'll be pushing that out to minus infinity. So this is why this is a more general class of the singularity models. That includes all reasonable ways to rescale around singularity. Okay. And then here's an example of something which is an ancient solution, but it's not one of the soliton examples that we looked at so far. And this is really the paperclip that we also saw in the applet, where we could play with finding these explicit, I wouldn't say explicit, but you could draw your own curves and then let them flow. And so what you should imagine here is, right, that if I took time to minus infinity, so this, I'll write a little bit humorously here, time equals more or less minus infinity, then it goes out like this, right? So at time equals more or less minus infinity, then you have this. And so it's not so hard to imagine here, which is also true, that this thing, okay, as it flows from minus infinity to the picture we now see here, then it will sweep out in space this strip-like region here, okay? And then, so that's what we'll look at on the next slides. But I should first also say here that actually, if you look at convex ancient solutions, then Daskalopoulos, Hamilton, and Sesson have classified all of these convex ancient solutions in two dimensions, so the curve shortening flow ones. So the only convex such ones are actually the shrinking circles and Antonin's paperclip. So they can see, right, that the circles, right, they will fill up going back into time all space, and then the paperclip here will do a strip. So that actually means that in the case of convex ancient solutions to the curve shortening flow, then only the case of all space and strips happen as the space sweeped out. So, but let me first also mention that there's quite a lot of new examples that have come out of convex examples of such ancient surfaces and or hypersurfaces. So if you look at, for example, White Engine and Hasselhoff-Herskovits have constructed examples of really these kind of overload versions of this in higher dimensions. And then it was also mentioned again, Wang and Burley, Langford and Sinalia, where, for example, the latter here have recently found some of these pancake looking solutions. So instead of being more overload like, they are, imagine taking this picture we are looking at of these paper clips and maybe rotating that around the y-axis shown in the middle. And then you can imagine something. I mean, of course, I'm not saying that's a solution. It's definitely not, but something of the same sort of pancake like solution of rotational symmetry. And then on the sort of flip side of this, there have also been many of these efforts to classify convex solutions, and a lot of these efforts have concentrated on the so-called alpha non-collapsed surfaces. This includes also convexity in the definition when you define it. And there's, for example, like I mentioned, some of the work by Brandon Choi and from 18 and further work also by Antin and Dusklopoulos and Sisson. But what we are doing, right, is we're in the business of these wedge theorems. So let's try to look at these sets in space that are reached by the flow. And this is then our theorem here from, you can see this preprint here, that if I take a proper ancient flow and then look at the region in space, and this then works in all of any Euclidean dimension and without any assumptions on it, apart from just as a proper ancient flow, and then the convex hull must be one of these simple types again. So the convex hull of the region sweeped out, meaning those are the points in space that will be at some point reached by the flow. You take the convex hull of that set, then you get either one of these. So one of these, you get either planes, slabs, half spaces, or all of space. Okay. And the proof idea, you'll not be so surprised, is that it's again a wedge theorem. So we'll use a Morial or a maximum principle. And but now we just have to use a parabolic version of it. And so the one we use is a modification of one which was done previously used by John Ma, who's now actually a postdoc in Copenhagen these days. And then it works for these proper ancient flows, this version that you make. And then you actually use the same function. And now the same function, which is the distance function to one of these n minus one dimensional affines in our n plus one. And now you work with this heat operator on the surfaces, and then you do similar computations and see that this gives you minus sub of the function again, which is negative. So if you want to say it in a fancy word, what you've shown is that you get at infinity, you get subcaloricity of this test function. And then this again contradicts the Omoriao principle and the Omoriao sequences properties. Okay, so as a corollary to this, right, then you can see that if we look at compact convex ancient flows, but now in any dimension, right, so then we can get a kind of weak classification here, because now the convex hull then has to be either a slab, a half space, or all of our n plus one. And then just as in the elliptic case of the self-translators, where we had an open problem, then this again gives an open problem, right? Because now we would like to find an example of an ancient solution which sweeps out exactly a half space. And I should say that, you remember that it was classified in the curve case of these compact solutions. Convex compact solutions, yeah, in the curve case, and then you couldn't have the half space case. So when I write here that John Ma has recently constructed an example of a half plane filling example of an ancient curve, then that's actually a non-compact and non-convex one, of course. So it's not ruled out by the classification theorem, and it's also, I should say, it's not embedded. Let's then talk a little bit about some some broader perspectives on it here. And I'll just tell a brief history of how all these results fit together. So you can see here that Omori, as we already said, regeneralized, which was actually not used by Huff and Meeks, right? They used this non-linear maximum principle, these surfaces that look like apple slices that came from the plateau problem. And then already Nietzsche has a paper which from 65, which seems to not have been known by Omori, it's not cited, where he looks at minimal surface graphs and shows that you cannot have graphs over these wedge-shaped regions with an angle strictly between 0 and pi. And so as also pointed out, then we have then included the minimal surface case in the result for translators, the elliptic result I talked about. And then the elliptic result, at least without boundary, is included in our parabolic version of the result for ancient flows. And then also you see that we clean up some of these other things, right? Because parts of these classification results of Wang and the others that I mentioned in the beginning, the case of bounded projections of graphs, including my own work here, and so on and so on. parts of that is also explained by this wedge theorem phenomenon that we see here. And then I can also refer and say that I remember that Boibeli really did this argument in the 2D case, and you also find that Besser, Delira, and Deiras have looked at Riemannian products and looked at some of these wedge theorems there. So again, a bit more about the broader views. What else can you use these things for? Well, one recent result by Brian White here from January 19, there he finished this old work he had been doing about the boundary regularity for mean curve to flow boundary. And if you look in the proof, it actually uses a wedge theorem for self-shrinking Brake flows. So you look in the geometric measure theory setting outside of the smooth category, the world of barefolds, and then you show this. So really, I mean, for the self-shrinkers, it's really, even somehow simpler to look at these things. And then I'll comment a bit on this also about these self-shrinkers, right? Because they obey actually even a half-space theorem through the origin. And you can see here, if you look at Pigola and Molendi via maximum principle, Carpentante Espinar, using as barriers these surfaces here that I discovered with Kleene in this transactions of the American Mathematical Society paper back there. And then you can show this, or as I said, Brian White has geometric measure theory versions of showing such a half space theorem for shrinkers through the origin. For the half space through the origin. And then I just could remark one small thing here, which is that if you thought maybe that if you have a version of a half space, or rather a wedge theorem without boundary, if you thought you could automatically make one with compact boundary, then actually these self shrinking trumpets like surfaces here from that paper of ours, each of those is a counterexample, right? Because they actually are entirely conical here and have a compact boundary there. So then they always sit, even in, if we take a big cone here, they sit there. So to say in this way, even though you have a half space theorem without boundary, then you cannot get even a wedge or a cone theorem in the case with compact boundary. So that's just an interesting little remark. And then finally, also want to say that the things we're doing here, where we look at these wedge theorems, you can see them as related to this Frankel property and a sort of loosen and strengthen at the same time. And just to remind you, if you didn't know what the Frankel property is, well, you say that the Riemannian manifold is Frankel if any two minimal surfaces inside it have to intersect somewhere. That's, for example, true if you have a lower bounded positive region like this. And then, of course, famously, in the recent resolution of Yao's conjecture, the existence of infinitely many distinct closed minimal surfaces by Fernando Marques, André Neves, and Antoine Song, then actually the work is divided between these two groups of people into separate cases, where it's the Frankel case versus the non-Frankel case. And so, yeah, as I'm saying, then what happens if you think about your Frankel condition, but then you loosen and strengthen it in the following ways. So instead of looking at all minimal surfaces, now you only look at one family of minimal surfaces, such as the vertical planes that we're looking at here. But now you ask that any surface has to intersect a pair of surfaces that are distinct from your family. Okay, so there you see that we both made it, it easier by restricting the family, but made it harder at the same time by having required that you intersect two surfaces. So they are clearly related there to these Frankel-esque theorems, you can say. Okay, and so I'll say thanks now for paying attention here, and I hope that I'll see some of you maybe at the GeoTop in Copenhagen, the Copenhagen Center for Geometry and Topology. And so, bye-bye.